بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا رب العالمين All praise is due to Allah and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us first have the proper intention in our hearts to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the following chapter is so important that people nowadays deal with without unfortunately learning about the rules pertaining to such a contract. It's about Al-Qiraad. Al-Qiraad, financing a profit sharing venture. Financing a profit sharing venture. The person who wants to give his money to someone to work in a kind of trading, selling, buying, then the profit will be shared between them. So he is the financier in that case. He's financing this investment, and that one is working, buying, selling, making a profit. Then they divide the profit between them based on the agreement. This happens, and here maybe the easiest term people would think of is investing one's money. A person has money, he doesn't have time to work in his money. He might give his money to someone and say to him, I want to invest this money with you. You trade with them and the profit is shared between us 50-50. It has rules that one has to observe in order for such a contract to be valid. Al-Qadi Abu Shuja' said, financing profit-sharing ventures is permissible. And remember, when I say permissible, it's not a liable contract. It's permissible. So he has the option to stop it, to not keep going with it. It's up to him. And not to go into it in the first place. So he's not obligated to do it. It's optional. He said, financing profit-sharing ventures is permissible with four conditions. First, the contract is based on golden or silver coins. According to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, you cannot deal with such a contract unless the money you are investing is either golden or silver coins, the currency. You know, dinar and dirham that they used to deal with as currency in the past, golden coins and silver coins. This is what you use. So the normal currency, the notes and the like, according to Shafi'i, it's invalid. So it's either golden coins or silver coins. But some scholars from the followers who is amongst the mujtahideen, Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Layla allowed this to be done on copper currency and the like. So even if it is not gold or silver. But according to Imam Shafi'i, the contract must be based on golden or silver coins. Second, the financier permits the worker to engage in trade that is unrestricted or restricted to things usually available. The financier stipulates for the worker a specific portion of the profit. The contract is not limited to a fixed duration. So these are the four conditions he mentioned. So the definition of it is as follows. One, giving his money to someone. He's investing his money with him. That one can trade with the money and the profit is shared between them. It doesn't have to be 50-50. Rather, it is based on the agreement. It could be 40%, 60%. Doesn't have to be 50-50. And the proof about the permissibility of such a contract is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went into this kind of contract when he invested the money of Khadija in Asham. So he traded with the money of Khadija in Asham based on this type of contract. And all the companions agreed unanimously that such a contract is permissible in our religion, provided that you fulfill all the conditions. So the first, they said the money used for investment must be either golden or silver currency. Either one of two things. That's according to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu. Second, the financier permits the worker to engage in trade that is unrestricted. So he cannot say to him, for instance, take this money and buy from this person his cars and sell them. That's too restricted. So that will be like wakala, as if he's authorizing him, tawkil, you know, tawkil, assigning him to act on his behalf. So there is no kind of business between them in that case. It doesn't work, so it's very restricted. Or for instance, he might say to him, take this money to trade with, but do not buy anything without my consultation. That's too much restriction. It doesn't work. It's invalid in that case. Or to say, do not sell whatever you buy without my permission. That's too much restriction in that case. The second thing is he cannot restrict him as well to things that are usually rare to be found. Such as to say, take this money and only buy with them black and white horses. So what he can find, black and white horses, that's very rare. So this kind of restriction as well is invalid. And he cannot specify to him which thing to buy with the money, like buy this amount of wheat and trade with them. Buy these clothes and trade with them. It's invalid in that case. Also, the financier stipulates for the worker a specific portion of the profit. When we say specific portion, we are talking about percentage only. And this is the valid qirad, or they call it as well mudaraba. In order for such an investment to be valid, the profit assigned for the worker must be by percentage. Take this money, invest them in trade, and the profit is shared between us 50-50, or I take 60%, you take 40%. Because here, as he's working with the money, trading with them, he might get that much of profit or that much of profit, he would get the percentage. So if it goes up or down, it's based on the percentage. He cannot make it based on a fixed rate. such as, or fixed payment, such as to say, take my money, trade with them, and I need from you every month $500. And it's not my responsibility if you make profit or if you don't. That's too risky. And remember, when risk is involved in a contract, that's what is called al-gharar. And this is forbidden in our religion. The Prophet forbade one from engaging in risky contracts. And here there is a risk, because he might not make profit during that period of time. And he's asking him for this set payment to be given to him. Like to give him, for instance, according to those who allowed, not to Shafi, according to those who allowed giving money, just to make it clearer. Or if I want to give an example, according to Imam Shafi, I would say, someone gave 20 dinars, dinars meaning that golden coins, 20 dinars to a person, and he said, trade with them, and I want, on top of them, that's the capital money, I want 10 dinars. That is my share from the trade. This is invalid, because he specified a set payment to be given to him. In order to be lawful, he would say to him, trade with them, and I want 60% of the profit, and you take 40%. So it is by proportion, not by set payment. Is that clear? So keep that in mind. So now there is a kind of contract that people go into these days, where a person wants to invest his money. He has money, he's not working with them, and someone might say to him, let us go into, they call it partnership, it's not partnership. It's a kind of qirad. Give me the money, I trade with them, and I give you each month that set payment. This is invalid. This is an invalid contract. So one has to be aware of it. Then he said, the contract is not limited to a fixed duration, such as to say, for instance, do not buy and sell after 1 year. He cannot restrict it in that way. But he can, however, say, do not buy new products after 1 year, only buying. Meaning, during that 1 year period, he would have bought products and sold them and so on. So after 1 year, do not buy new products. And let us see how much profit you made, and we divide them. But he cannot restrict it. For instance, to say, take these dinars, trade with them for 1 month. This is invalid, because he might not get the profit during that month. Then he said, the worker is not liable for losses and damages except in the case of transgression. If the owner of the money invested his money with someone else to trade with, and they agreed that the profit is shared between them 50-50. Now, without any shortage from that person, the worker, without any shortage from his side, he bought products, then the value depreciated dramatically, and he had to sell them, and they lost. Here, the investor wouldn't say to him, look, I don't care, I need my money back, give me the capital money, and on top, I need the portion of the profit. He lost. Let us say he invested 20 dinars. He bought certain products with them. The value depreciated dramatically. When he sold them, he got only 15 dinars. So there is loss here. He wouldn't say to the worker, you pay me 5 dinars from your own pocket. Here, the owner of the money will take the responsibility of the losses and damages. Unless, he said, it was due to transgression, negligence. So the worker bought something with the money, and out of negligence, he put them in a place where they got destroyed and damaged out of negligence, then he will be liable for the losses and the damages. But if there was no shortage from his side, he is not liable for the losses and damages. Then he said, if there is both profit and loss, the loss is compensated by the profits. Because the profit here is guarantor for the losses, for the capital money. Because as we mentioned, that sometimes the price depreciates. Let us say they bought sheep. He bought 100 sheep with the money, and some of them died. So this is not in his hand. It wasn't out of negligence from his side. Some of them died. That's the loss. Then he sold the rest, and he made profit. That profit will compensate the loss. So by this we concluded, talking about this type of contract, and as we mentioned, it is not a binding contract. That means anytime they can nullify and dissolve this contract between them. And if one dies or becomes insane, it will be automatically nullified as well. The last contract we'd like to talk about in our lesson is about watering fruits for a stipulated portion. Al-Qadi Abu Shuja' said watering fruits for a stipulated portion is permissible for palm trees and grapevines. So according to Shafi'i, only in these two kinds of trees, the palm trees and the grapevines. So not in fig trees, for instance, or apricot, for instance, or peaches and the like. Not in these ones, only in two, palm trees and grapevines. He said it has two conditions, the specification of a known duration and the specification of a known portion of the fruits for the worker. So from the term in Arabic, Al-Musaqaat, watering, one would understand what's the concept behind it. A person has a garden. It is filled with palm trees. He's the owner of this garden, filled with palm trees, over 100. He doesn't have the time to look after it. He might make this kind of contract with a person. We call him the worker. So this is the owner of the land, the landlord. And you have the worker now. They come up to an agreement. The worker will look after the trees. When we say he looks after them, to make sure that they give fruits, and that will need watering, will need taking care of them, picking them when it is the time for picking, and also fertilizing. You know, there is a kind of fertilization they make to give more fruits. they do that for the dates. So anything that would serve the fruit will be on the worker from that work. Then when they sell the fruits, or when it is the time for the harvest, these fruits will be shared between the worker and the owner of the land. That's the concept of it. And this is also deduced from the hadith narrated by Muslim from the root of Ibn Umar, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the land of Khaybar for a portion of what it produces from the fruits. This can be done, as we mentioned. One has a land, he doesn't have time to look after it. He might make this contract with another person. That worker will look after the land until it's the time for the harvest. He will harvest everything and they will share the fruits between them based on the agreed portion they have. And as mentioned here, it's only about palm trees and grapevines, not in anything else. And there are conditions that must be met as well. He said the first one is the specification of a known duration. So he needs to give him to assign a time. The scholar said he wouldn't say to him that we make this contract of watering the fruits until the fruits become ripe. He wouldn't say it in that way. Rather, he might say for a year. And usually, for a year, they will have the harvest. So he might say for a year. So he needs to specify a period of time. Second, the specification of a known portion of the fruits for the worker. As we mentioned, 50%, 40%, they need to agree on something. Then he added by saying, furthermore, there are two types of work involved therein. Work the benefit of which returns to the fruits, and that is required from the worker. And work the benefit of which returns to the land, and that is required from the landlord. Now, what kind of work is involved when watering the trees? One might be in need of digging trenches in the land, fixing the water mills or water wheels to water the whole land. He might be in need of building a fence around the land. So these matters are in the land. Here the landlord will be liable for all these things, all these costs. So he pays for all these things. The other type of work that goes to the fruit itself, and that is like fertilizing the trees, picking the fruits, and taking care of them so they can give a good yeast at the end of the time of the harvest. That's what he needs to take into consideration. All these types of work are on the worker. Now, while we mention this, this kind of contract was legitimized for the need. However, what some people these days do, which is invalid, it happens a lot in Lebanon. A person would have a land. He has in it, let us say, olive trees, maybe apple trees, orange trees, and the like. He doesn't want to work in it. He makes a contract with someone to take care of the land, and he says to him, I want from you at the end of the year or after 1 year $10,000. $10,000, regardless of what fruits you might get or what you might sell and the like, there is a big risk in it. He might not get enough fruits to sell to get that amount of money. For that reason, it is invalid. So just keep that in mind. If one were to engage in any contract, so whether you want to invest your money with someone else to trade with, and you want to share the profit at the end, you need to be aware of all these rules. Otherwise, dispute might arise, and people will spend the rest of their money in courts. But if they learn from the beginning what they are entitled to Islamically, if they were to go into that contract, that will give them peace of mind. Before you get engaged in any transaction, any contract, ask, can I do this Islamically? What are the conditions? Because, as we mentioned before, the consequences of engaging in contracts without being aware of the rules will entail sometimes of consuming the money of others unjustly. That's a major sin. Sometimes one becomes in a situation where he needs to return the money. It would become difficult to find the real owners of the money and the like. So there are certain things that might be involved, and one's body will be nurtured from the haram money and the like, so one has to be aware of all that before you engage in any contract. Now, we are explaining the contract mentioned in the books of fiqh. Now, the amount of contracts available outside are numerous, and most of them do not comply with the rules of the religion. And as we mentioned before, it's not enough for one to say, yeah, but we both agree. Agreement does not make it permissible Islamically. You might agree on something that is haram. So being happy about the contract doesn't make it halal. Having agreed on the contract doesn't make it halal. Putting conditions doesn't make it halal if it is against the rules of the religion. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in the hadith that every condition that does not comply with the book of Allah is falsehood, even if it were to be 100 conditions. So it doesn't matter how many conditions or terms and conditions. Now they say, you see 3 pages, very fine print, you need to go through all these terms and conditions. Yeah, if they do not comply with the rules of the religion, they are invalid. That doesn't make the contract permissible. So just keep that in mind, barakallahu feekum, before you engage in any contract, inshaAllah azza wa jal. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase our knowledge and benefit us with the knowledge we have acquired. Ameen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. We say la ilaha illallah and make salah on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.